Now that we know what cells are made of and what they use, how do cells let these molecules, like carbohydrates and proteins, in and out of the cell? The cell has many structures inside that do the processes, but it's protected by this layer called the cell membrane.
All of those structures and organelles have different functions, but cells are not isolated little worlds. They do have a lot going on inside them, but they also need to interact with their environment. It makes sense that to keep a stable environment inside themselves, otherwise known as keeping homeostasis, they must have some control on what goes in and what goes out of them. A very important structure for this that all cells contain is the cell membrane. By controlling what goes in and out, the cell membrane helps regulate homeostasis. It's the homeostasis king. Let's take a look at the cell membrane. You could have a whole course on the cell membrane itself. It has amazing structure. It has signaling abilities. But to stick to the very basics, it's made of a phospholipid bilayer. Bilayer means two layers, so you have these two layers of lipids. Now, these lipids, they're called phospholipids, well, they have a head that is polar, and they have a tail that is nonpolar, making them quite unique. Some molecules, they have no problem going through the cell membrane, and they directly go through the phospholipid bilayer. Very small, nonpolar molecules, they fit in this category. They're a great example. Like some gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide gas, those are great examples. This is known as simple diffusion. Also, it doesn't take any energy to force those molecules in or out, so it's known as passive transport. Simple diffusion moves with the flow, meaning it moves with the concentration gradient.
Let's give an example to help understand concentration. Imagine you had a room filled with little bouncy balls, and you open the door into a hallway which has no bouncy balls. Some of it is going to spill out. That is because the room, which has a high concentration, meaning it has a lot, is going to spill out into an area of low concentration in the hallway. This is called the concentration gradient, where it's going to go from high to low concentration.
Molecules move from high concentration to low concentration. So when you hear someone saying that something's going with the concentration gradient, that's what they mean. They mean it's going from a high concentration of molecules to a low concentration of molecules. Now, remember how we said the cell membrane is actually a pretty complex structure? Well, one thing we haven't mentioned yet are proteins in the membrane, and some of them are transport proteins. Some transport proteins act as channels. Some of these proteins actually change their shape to get things across. Some of them open and closed based on some kind of stimulus. All of these are good things because it's helping with molecules that may be too big to cross the membrane on their own, or molecules that are polar and therefore need the help of a transport protein. This is known as facilitated diffusion. It's still diffusion, and it still moves with the concentration gradient of high to low. It doesn't require energy, though, so it's also a type of passive transport. It's just the proteins are facilitating, or helping, things pass. Charged ions often require a protein channel in order to pass through. Glucose needs the help of a transport protein to pass through. In osmosis, for water to travel at a fast rate across the membrane, it passes through protein channels called aquaporins. So these are all examples of facilitated diffusion, which is a type of passive transport and moves with the concentration gradient of high to low concentration. Now all the transport we've mentioned has been passive in nature. That means it's going from high concentration to low concentration. But what if you want to go the other way? For example, the cells lining your gut, they need to take in glucose. But what if the concentration of glucose in the cell is higher than the amount of glucose concentration in the environment? We still need to get the glucose in, so it's going to have to be forced against the regular gradient flow.
Back in our example, what if you wanted to take some of those bouncy balls that spilled into the hallway back into the room? You would actively have to pick up those bouncy balls and put them back into the room, which requires some energy. And this is what active transport is when you're going against the concentration gradient.
Movement of molecules from low to high concentration will take energy because that's against the flow. Typically, it's going to require ATP energy. A reminder that ATP, adenosine triphosphate, it has three phosphates. And when the bond for the last phosphate is broken, it releases a great amount of energy. Yeah, so ATP is a pretty awesome little molecule. ATP can power active transport to force molecules to go against their concentration gradient.
At this point, you're probably used to those pop-ups, which means there's a question about this concept down below, so please make sure to answer that correctly, and see you in the next one.